Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Use your head to get your foot in the door. Job search secrets no one else will tell you. Written by Harvey Mackay. Read by Erik. Dedication. This book is dedicated to the dedicated, those millions of people who are resolved to make a career comeback, no matter how trying and challenging the triumph may be. Dedicated to maintaining a positive attitude, knowing full well that every day's frustrations, big and small, can easily drain the enthusiasm and energy to make a breakthrough. Dedicated to learning, accepting, and then acting on the hard facts of how they really rank in the job market, and committed to improve their lot through focused hard work. Dedicated to taking stock of their entire skill set, and determined that they will be as techno-smart as their next competitor. Dedicated to keeping their network of personal contacts alive, fresh, and relevant to their career plan. Dedicated to the realization that getting a job is far harder than having a job, and willing to work the hours and to discipline their time far beyond how they might when they collected a regular paycheck. Dedicated to exhaustive preparation in advance of any job search step, be it polishing a resume, approaching a recruiter, or appearing for an interview. Dedicated to the inescapable truth that modern life is no one-stop search, but a perpetual journey through multiple job and career changes. This book is dedicated to those who want to climb back into the ring, because I want nothing more than to share these pointers that will land you the knockout win you so deeply desire. 10 Reasons to Buy This Book. This program will teach you the surefire techniques to secure a job in the worst economy in decades. It also gives you the tools to conduct the lifetime search you can expect, with the 3 to 5 career shifts and the 12 to 15 job changes of the typical person's working life. 1. Master the winning attitude and positive psychology necessary to re-enter the workforce successfully after having been fired, reorganized, downsized, or re-engineered out of a job. 2. Build, expand, and energize the network of contacts and power figures that will open the doors to your ultimate career opportunities. 3. Learn the secret preparation tools that will enable you to design a foolproof resume in the internet age. 4. Bolster your confidence to overcome disabling rejection and maneuver decisively in making new contacts. 5. Develop the personal awareness and planning disciplines needed to execute a flawless job interview. 6. Explain the most difficult, disappointing, and embarrassing lapses in your career and personal development. 7. Absorb the negotiation skills to exit your last job with maximum advantage and to enter your newest responsibility with optimum opportunity. 8. Understand the demanding world of recruiters, employment directors, and industrial psychologists, and learn the messages they long to hear. 9. Grasp use of the latest communications technology and databases to give you number one positioning in the candidate pool for the best jobs. 10. Build the staging strategy you will need to identify and secure your next job targets, while you use your present position for your and your employer's best benefit. Preface. A recent New York Times article pointed out that public libraries across the country have been combat zones, as millions of people line up outside of cubicles to attempt online job searches, and tempers flare. Some have never sent emails, and many more don't have a clue about assembling and submitting a resume in the electronic age. The unemployment rate was 10.2% in November 2009, the highest in more than a quarter century. The personal bankruptcies, divorces, broken families, and shattered plans for a college education are the more common and widespread aftermaths. Statistics paint a powerful portrait of the changing world of work, and this book pinpoints some of the most dramatic ones like these. A 2007 Gallup poll in Time magazine reported 77% of all Americans hated their jobs. And according to current labor statistics, the average person will have at least 3 to 5 career changes and 10 to 14 different jobs by age 38. Many people think they have embarked on the most important job search of their life. The truth that's now sinking in is this: we are all engaged in a lifetime job search. The illusion of a lifetime job is a myth that died along with a gold retirement watch 20 years ago. What people need today is a lifetime job strategy and the tools to make it continuously successful. That's what this book is about. I've mentored hundreds of new grads and seasoned veterans, and I can help you too. Harvey Mackay, February 1st, 2010. Dark Days. Chapter 1. Against All Odds. How Preparation Prevailed. Early in 2008, we had a get-together at our home in Phoenix. 200 visitors bustled around the grounds on a pleasantly cool evening. As the clock neared midnight, I noticed one guest was lingering. It was Vinny Del Negro, assistant general manager of the Phoenix Suns. He finally marched up and asked if he could see me alone. I knew this had to be big time. We adjourned to my office, and Vinny's wife, Lynn, strolled off to poolside with my spouse, Carol Ann. Vinny Del Negro's dad played basketball at the University of Kentucky under one of the all-time great coaches, Adolph Rupp. Like father, like son. Vinny was elected to the All-Atlantic Coast Conference, All-ACC team, after leading the North Carolina State Wolf Pack to the laurels in the 1987 ACC tournament. And Vinny was singled out as Most Valuable Player, MVP, for setting the pace. During his National Basketball Association, NBA career, Vinny started for 6 years for the San Antonio Spurs, before stints with the Milwaukee Bucks and the Golden State Warriors. A trade brought him to the Phoenix Suns in 2000. In 2003, after retiring as a player, he did television and radio commentary for the Suns, and was soon promoted, first to director of player personnel, and then to assistant general manager. What's on Vinny's mind on this starry Arizona evening? I enjoy working in the front office, Harvey, but I want to be an NBA head coach, he says. That takes my breath away. Well, I said, that's one stretchy objective. Let's start by taking a look at your track record. I know you've never coached in the NBA, but you surely did some college coaching along the way. No. I see, I comment hesitantly, before I probe a little deeper. Well, even though it was a long time ago, you surely helped your high school coach as an assistant? No, never did. Grade school? Maybe you did some coaching in grade school? No, sir. Can't say that I had the chance, Harvey. You really want to do this, Vinny? More than anything. You've never coached a day in your life, and the job you're aiming at is that of head coach? Since that coaching position had opened up for the Phoenix Suns, what better opportunity could present itself? He nodded. I will guarantee you one thing in blood. I sighed. I know Suns owner Robert Sarver very well. This guy is the youngest person in American history to establish a national bank. He got where he is by surrounding himself with experienced people. He is only going to go with a known coach. Vinny didn't flinch, and I could see the determination burning in his eyes. Vinny, if you want to come over tomorrow for 4 hours with your legal pad in hand, I'll teach you how to do the interview. You're not going to get this job, but I can't imagine a better trial run because you are already so deep into the Phoenix organization. If you handle this opportunity right, despite your total void in coaching experience, I guarantee you'll be a finalist in coaching searches in the future. That will stick, as long as there's the NBA. The next day, Vinny drops by. Over bagels and apple juice, we do our chalk talk. Off he goes, and in the coming weeks, he handles, I should say aces, his interview with the Suns. Harvey, I think I'm going to be considered very seriously. That's great, Vinny, I say. Remember everything you say and do, because this is the most important job you'll never get. Days pass. Vinny calls. Harvey, guess what? I didn't get the job. They hired Terry Porter, who, as you know, had been head coach with the Bucks and then an assistant in Detroit. "We're batting 1,000, I say. "What do you have in mind next?" I ask. "I'm heading to Orlando for the pre-draft camp, and when I get back, I will reevaluate everything and move forward." While in Orlando, Vinny has a chance to sit down with John Paxson, the general manager of the Chicago Bulls. At the time, Jim Boylan's role as interim coach in Chicago had ended. Another opportunity presented itself for Vinny. "Go get him," I say. The first interview is promising. Vinny says, "I really do believe I have a chance to be a finalist." Second interview, and Vinny reaches me at the office saying, "I am a finalist." "Vinny," I remind him, "I told you you'd be a finalist. But the Bulls are probably the bluest chip franchise in the entire NBA. The third interview is with the owner, Jerry Reinsdorf. I know this guy. You'll do well, but go back and study the apple juice stained notes of yours from our powwow." On June 10th, 2008, Vinny calls and catches me with clients at a baseball game. I was wrong. His preparation, perseverance, and passion prevailed. He got the top job. Vinny Del Negro was named the new head coach of the Chicago Bulls. In April-May 2009, the Bulls faced the Boston Celtics in the NBA playoffs. Vinny asked my assistant Greg to send him a stack of my 35 best columns on motivation to share with his players. Did they help? Who knows? But this I do know. Due in large measure to the unscalable determination of Vinny Del Negro, the Bulls battled the Celtics to 7 games, 2 in overtime, 1 in double overtime, and 1 in triple overtime. Hardwood devotees considered to have been the best first round of NBA postseason play ever. There are lessons here, to be sure. The most important? Networking and relevant experience are the investment that builds a great career. The only place where opportunity springs up out of the blue is in the movies. And any actor will tell you. You won't even get a chance to play those zany, surreal parts without grueling, methodical experience and knowing the right people. There are few substitutes for determination and self-confidence in getting a shot at the job you want. With those two mighty engines, you will level the thickest steel-reinforced doors with a few swift kicks. But knocking down the door, as crucial as that is not locking up the job. And there is absolutely, positively no substitute for preparation in aiming the shots you get so that they land squarely in the bullseye. You can have the finest moves in the talent contest. You can boast a trophy speed dial list on your iPhone. You can possess the single-mindedness of Paul Revere and be as self-assured as Muhammad Ali. And you still won't nail the job unless you know how to mold and merchandise your personal pitch. If this is true when times are booming, and it is, you can only imagine how true it is in times like these. This book is about bundling that crushing zigzag lightning you have recently absorbed and hurling it back in one focused thunderbolt to land you on the payroll and to keep you there. Chapter 2. 7 Danger Signals You May Soon Be Out of a Job. It's not your bad breath keeping you on the outskirts. Suddenly your boss invites your second-in-command to meetings you usually attend, but forgets to ask you. Or your office is abruptly relocated 2 floors away from the C-suite, or your department's power alley. Or you are transferred to Novosibirsk or Chisinau, Moldova, with a glorious opportunity to build a brand new market and report back in 5 years. Your organization chart is rerouted. You now report to somebody with much less clout or stature than your last chief. Perhaps your new boss is the outfit's Attila the Hun, who specializes in dirty work like axing longtimers. Your prize subordinate and backup is reassigned. An overqualified new hire is parked in your department until the right spot opens up. The meat is trimmed off meetings with your boss. Those weekly half-hour status sessions become monthly 15-minute rush jobs, if they happen at all. However, when he or she does see you, the talk is all about hard-fisted goals, especially the ones that you are having the toughest time achieving. Communication chat content drops to zero. The emails and phone calls you get are strictly about measurement against the numbers or measurable benchmarks. And watch for this dead giveaway. Bad news or criticism is repeated to you twice, spoken slowly and clearly, or sent to you in writing, when it would normally have been an offhand comment. You are put decidedly out of the loop. Your department is up for restructuring, but no one's asking your opinions. Suddenly your boss makes your decision for you, the one you've been weighing for the last 2 months. You're no longer asked to train new staff members. You vanish off the mail trail, especially for insider plans on competition and strategy. You are now seen as fully qualified for your job. Why waste time sending you to training programs? You are the object of a neatness campaign. Control freaks from the personnel department descend on you and your staff. Your boss wants the box score and all your timing and action calendars. And by the way, how about a copy of your CMS, contact management system, with all those phone numbers and email addresses? You call up your personnel records, and overnight, every typo and sloppy entry has been airbrushed away. You feel like you have been cordoned off in quarantine. Nobody asks for your photo to tack on to the house blog. Buddies in other departments forget to invite you for an after-hours watering hole stop. When the company is quoted in the press, other voices say the things you were once asked to utter. And after not hearing from him for 16 days, your boss has just texted you this message on your BlackBerry. He wants to have a talk with you, next week, away from the office. Now I wonder what the topic might be. Chapter 3. Play for Keeps. Hold on to your job. A Survivor's Handbook. In the last half century, there has been a torrent of new laws and principles in medicine, economics, business, the sciences, and of course the legal system. None astonishes me more than Moore's Law, formulated by Gordon E. Moore in 1965. A co-founder of Intel, Moore contended that the number of transistors that could be economically loaded on an integrated circuit would double about every 2 years. The Caltech PhD was right as rain, and so appreciative of the good schooling he got that he and his wife have since enriched Caltech by a crisp $600 million, the biggest donation in history to a college or university. What's so peachy about Moore's Law? Moore is describing the enormous increase in memory within computers, cars, phones, and nearly every other gadget we use. The most incredible thing of all? Moore's Law is expected to continue to prevail until the year 2015. In case somebody hasn't formulated it yet, and somebody may well have done so, let me throw a new one at you. I'll call it Mackay's Law, and it works this way. Take the number of people in your department. Let's say it's 25. My projection is in 5 years, that number is likely to be 15. That means an average attrition rate of 2 bodies a year. Moore's Law is part of the reason. As computer memory skyrockets, not only does the volume of machine-made calculations increase, the complexity of things computers can do will also multiply, and in amazing ways. If a Toyota robotic trumpeter can already belt out a flawless version of Somewhere Over the Rainbow, you can be sure unimaginable labor and management savings technology is headed our way. The innovations will be over the moon. They will slay us, literally, at the rate of 2 per year in the workplace. Keeping your job will be a lot like navigating a survivor obstacle course in reality TV. In Greek mythology, mighty Hercules had to perform 12 labors of repentance. One of the labors of Hercules was death-defying, like bringing back Cerberus, the vicious multi-headed guard dog of Hades. And he had to do it barehanded. A second labor was to wash out the biggest, rankest cattle stalls found in glorious old Greece. Suicide mission, and sloughing through deep doo-doo. Sounds like all in a day's work for the modern manager. Mackay's moral. In the future world of jobs, more means less. Quickie. How bad can things get? One day, as I sat musing, sad and lonely and without a friend, I heard a voice out of nowhere say, "Cheer up. Things could be worse." So I cheered up, and sure enough, things got worse. Chapter 4. Things change, and it pays to know how. When I was growing up as a kid, the U.S. GDP was in the hundreds of millions. Then it went to billions. According to CNBC, that number in the second quarter of 2009 was $13.7 trillion. The media is constantly confusing billions with trillions and vice versa. We have been so desensitized with these numbers, it's hard to comprehend them. A quick little drill. I'm going to ask you to count from 1 to a trillion right now, and please stay awake until you finish this little assignment. How long will this take? 31,658 years. When I graduated from the University of Minnesota in 1954, a gallon of milk cost 92 cents, a loaf of bread, 17 cents. The high for the Dow Jones was 338, and I drove a fire engine red Pontiac Star Chief with a sticker price of $2,500. In 1981 to 82, milk had risen to $2.23 a gallon. Bread had climbed to 53 cents a loaf. The Dow was at about 900, and a Pontiac Firebird went for around $8,000. Fall 2009, a gallon of milk is $2.69. A loaf of bread is $2.80. The Dow has bounced back above 9,000. And the Pontiac? That make won't even be around by next year. Recently, I saw a video on YouTube that Sony played at an executive conference this year. It points out how dramatically the world has changed and is changing. China will soon become the number one English-speaking country in the world. Incidentally, when I was at the Olympic Games in China last summer, I learned that 300 million people play basketball in China, the same number of people who live in the United States. The 25% of India's population with the highest IQs is greater than the total population of the United States. Translation: India has more honors kids than America has kids. We are living in times of exponential growth. There are 31 billion searches on Google every month. In 2006, this number was less than a billion. For students starting a 4-year technical degree, half of what they learn in their first year of study will be outdated by their third year of study. Changes such as these can have a direct impact on you because they have a dramatic effect on the global employment market. Mackay's moral: what you don't know can hurt you, and it usually draws first blood from your pocketbook. Chapter 5. 12 Herculean Labors to Keep You on the Payroll. 1. Make yourself indispensable. There are as many ways to make yourself indispensable as there are reasons for your boss to cut you loose. It pays to whip up the glue that will help you stick around. Does your sales manager beef that no one is a team player? Hand off the ball every chance you get, and then dive in blocking to help the other guy score a touchdown. No one wants to touch the export trade opportunities to Upper Catatonia because their tariff laws are so complex, even though the CEO thinks this is the mother of all untapped markets. Spend your weekends tracking down every detail you can on the web. Maybe even hire an international trade law student to help you dig through the downloads. The otherwise bright human resources director's administrative assistant thinks a JPEG file is something you stick on a message board. In an instant, you see your opening to become the most gifted and patient IT skills tutor on the company team. 2. Rev up your horsepower and flash it. Holiday Inn founder Kemmons Wilson always believed you could get by working half days, and it didn't matter much if you worked the first 12 hours of the day or the second. If the hours for your job are 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., clock in at 7 a.m. and out at 6 p.m., and really spend that extra time working. There will be few others there for you to waste your precious moments jawing. The clock doesn't care how you spend your time. 6 p.m. will still come at 6 p.m. If the guy or gal in the next cubicle is working a straight 40 and making pretty much the same dough, it won't take long before the boss figures out that you are a bargain by a factor of 1.5. Let's say your boss likes to work late. There can be a schmooze percentage if you do too. Or your boss may like to work late and values having someone reliable cover the bases while he sleeps in. There's no magic formula, but it's up to you to figure out the hours that will yield the biggest personal payoff for you. 3. Volunteer. In the Army, never volunteering is the 11th commandment. In business, volunteering may well be the first opportunity. What does your boss hate to do? Is it sitting at his notebook and entering the weekly status report? How can you do it for him? There will always be a place in this world for the person who says, "I'll take care of it," and then does it. 4. Stick out and shine. The invisible guy is first to go, warns executive recruiter Stephen Biscuzzi in a recent Fortune article. It doesn't matter how you shine, as long as it's positive for the company. Play third base on the softball team. If your boss's favorite charity is a soup kitchen for the down and out, learn how to ladle. Shoot the marketing VP that hot-off-the-press competitor's brochure a customer left in your office. Sprinkle your profile all over the company landscape. It's a lot harder to terminate a face than a social security number. 5. Don't hang out with gloom and doom. You know the types. They constantly gripe about the pay scale, the benefits, and the career opportunities. Management always makes the wrong calls, as they see it. The people who are dismissed never deserve to be. And the company's market strategy? It's headed to hell in a handbasket. Even if you never utter a negative word, tag along with this bunch, and odds are high you'll be written off as a silent sympathizer. 6. Be a builder and a rebuilder. When staff cutbacks happen, be the first to help the new streamlined organization to work, even when it costs extra hours and sweat. If the sales department loses a big account because of quality problems, and you're in manufacturing, be the first to step up and say the client was right, and here's what we can do to help win that account back. 7. Always position yourself as number 2 to your next career opportunity. If you report directly to the head of your department or division, your first waking thought in the morning is what you will do that day to improve your chances of being the chief's backup. That includes the great idea you have been dreaming up to get that honcho promoted. The law of large numbers guarantees that some number 2 somewhere will be number 1 someday. With surprising frequency, that number 2 is an inside dark horse. 8. Persevere. In a rotten economy, it's so easy to throw in the towel. Hey, why not the whole linen closet? Top managers always have an eye out for people who do the opposite and engage themselves in tough problems, the ones who stick with finding a solution even after many reversals, and especially the ones who can keep up departmental morale among subordinates and peers in the darkest hours. 9. Educate yourself one notch up. Skilled marketers practice nichemanship in defining a tightly focused market and then bombarding it with custom-designed products. Savvy career survivors practice notchmanship. They study the resumes of managers on the next level and do their best to match and even surpass their career credentials. This isn't just restricted to formal degrees. It means loading up on those books, business journals, trade industry reports, websites, and bloggers that your firm's leading lights favor. 10. Pay attention to your duds. The clothes you wear, as I explain in the chapter A Winning Suit Trumps, assert your authority to subordinates, peers, the media, and most of all, to customers. Companies spend fortunes on their image. Your career is much likelier to blossom if you look like an extension of the company's public face, rather than an eyesore who escaped from the deep storage vault. 11. Think big picture. Your annual performance review is next week, and the departmental budget is stretched. recalling retired CBS anchorman Dan Rather, as tight as a too-small bathing suit on a too-hot car ride back from the beach. Back off. Maybe you come out and say the review can wait. There are more important priorities. Chances are you won't need to say anything at all. Cynics may brand you as a chump. In the tug of war to stay employed, you're likelier to come across as the champ who still has a desk. 12. And lastly, practice modesty. Indeed, you should do your best to make yourself indispensable. Indeed, you should not boast about it. Wisdom worthy to be reflected on each day. If you think you're indispensable, put your finger in a bowl of water and check out the hole it leaves when you pull it out. The trick is to be indispensable, not to strut around the office as though you were. Chapter 6. The Last to Learn. It's a sad truth that employees are often the last to learn that their companies are in serious trouble and about to embark on a major downsizing program. The internal rumor mill is usually the least reliable source to counteract this. First, notorious gossipers crave sensational news. For them, dramatic counts far more than factual. Second, many companies know how to manage the rumor mill by feeding it just the kind of unreliable news that keeps employees and everyone else off balance. Is there anything you can do to improve your chances of getting dependable first alert warnings on your employer? Every employee in today's world needs to assemble his or her own personal intelligence system. That's not done overnight. Executive recruiters can be an excellent information source. Consider regularly contacting the recruiter who placed you in your job and building a trust factor so that he or she might share information about industry trends and issues. Financial analysts always monitor quarterly financial reports to see if a large number of executive stock options are exercised. It's public information for public companies, and you can access it over the internet. Watch your boss. Often in impending crises, managers are given strict orders not to say anything. That causes more than a few people to button up about everything. When you notice a sudden outbreak of tight-lippedness, an alarm bell should start clanging in your mind. Stay on the lookout for unusual corporate behaviors. Analysts in the Middle East always keep a watchful eye when a government stocks up on hospital beds in a potential hotspot, or when the spouses and children of top leaders in a particular district are all abroad at the same time. Similarly, is the personnel department working unusually late hours? Are corporate meeting rooms blocked out for some unexplained period? One corporate insider I knew always sensed something was afoot when the number of bags coming out of the corporate shredder room suddenly spiked. Vendors and suppliers can be rich sources, especially ones who have been around long enough to read the tea leaves. A major reduction in raw materials orders is a nearly certain signal that production is going to be cut back. Let's say your boss, unbeknownst to you, has picked up a tip that the axe will soon be swinging. He or she is out on the market, aggressively shopping the next job opportunity with competitors. That may cause a competitor to call you or a colleague, aware that a feeding frenzy for available candidates may be in the making. Be aware of any sudden change in the level of competitor interest in recruiting people from your firm. If a competitor's headquarters has a nearby watering hole, there is often much to be learned just by dropping by on a Friday evening and listening to the chatter. Competitors make it their business to learn about the ups and downs of rivals, and may talk about the other guys far more freely than they would their own business. The truth is that change happens like wildfire these days. Even if you do all the above, lightning may still strike you. There will, however, be a big difference. Rather than living a complacent life, you will expect that a jolt is on the horizon, and you will likely be undertaking measures to dodge it. Mackay's moral. A reliable handle on tomorrow's news is one way to get a grip on an axe poised to swing. Quickie. Fine-tune your job description without being asked. Living in fear of loss of job and income, management guru Peter Drucker once wrote, is incompatible with taking responsibility for job and work group, for output and performance. When Drucker wrote this, he was chiefly talking about the safety nets of unemployment compensation and severance pay. But he also added, "Wherever a business has provided real job and income security, resistance to change or to innovation has disappeared." There is also a powerful hidden lesson in this outlook when you apply it to today's job world. The reason why so many people are casualties of massive company cutbacks is often that they did not take the initiative themselves to redefine their own jobs and make them more relevant. Every several months, you should take a look at your job description and make some notes on it. What things are you spending time doing that your boss thinks are less or more important today than they have been several months ago? What things are being done by your boss that he or she sees as significant drains on his or her time, and which you could perhaps help with and share his or her burden? What are customers complaining about that is reversing their buying decisions or undercutting their loyalty to your firm? And which of these fall into your scope or responsibility? Constantly initiate change to your own job to keep pace with company innovations and new market conditions. The best road to job security is to keep your job relevant. Chapter 7. Yours to Lose. Widgetronics Global Resources is about to staff its marketing director position. You are the leading contender for the job. In fact, you are the proverbial shoe-in. You have 8 years' experience with Widgetronics in consumer affairs. To broaden your exposure to the overall workings of the firm, you have just spent 8 successful additional years on assignment in new product development and sales. Everyone is convinced the marketing directorship is yours to lose. A loosely organized token search is conducted, just to verify that no outside contender could be anywhere near as qualified as you are. Your colleagues have drafted their congratulatory messages and are just waiting to plug in the dates. Soon, the victory balloons will be heaving in a net over your office desk, waiting to cascade down when the announcement is made. After a few weeks of deliberation, management announces its decision. The verdict? You lose. Stunned, you are determined to analyze the loss. Because there was such certainty you would win, your supporters never organized a cohesive campaign to back you. Your biggest advocate was the retiring marketing director, who, larger than life, chimed in with impromptu endorsements and gratuitously diminished the competition. You failed to brush up on the details of your own achievements in consumer affairs several years ago, and slipped up in responses to questions in your own interviews. A whole new group of entry-level marketing staff members had staged a relentless campaign with management, saying that a grassroots change was needed in marketing management, one that was highly responsive to the internet age. Unlikely scenario? Consider how Hillary Clinton lost the Democratic presidential nomination in 2008. Her campaign was never properly organized and managed. Her husband, the popular former President Bill Clinton, was viewed at times as a meddlesome surrogate. Muddled recollections about a Bosnia visit in 1996 tarnished the credibility of her first lady experience. She cultivated the old guard of the party, at the expense of a powerfully organized and digitally able younger generation. Mackay's moral: in the staffing game, overconfidence and a flawed plan can pull defeat from the jaws of victory. Quickie: misery is contagious, too. A wimpy guy walks into a bar and is hovering over his drink. All of a sudden, a 6'6" monster guy, wearing boots, chains, and tattoos, elbows him off the bar stool. Godzilla grabs the wimp's drink, inhales it, and hollers at him, "How do you like that, sonny?" "Hey, mister, I'm having a bad day," the wimpy guy replies. "I got up early this morning and went to work, only to find out I got downsized out of my job. I went home at noon to tell my wife the bad news, and she left me. They stole my car this afternoon. And now I come in here to commit suicide, and you drink my poison." Chapter 8. Beat Rejection Before It Beats You.
How are you getting along? Asked the old-timer of the new sales rep.
Not so good, came the sales rep's disgusted reply. I've been insulted in every place I made a call.
That's funny, said the old-timer. I've been on the road 40 years. I've had my samples flung in the street, been tossed downstairs, manhandled by janitors, and rolled in the gutter. But insulted? Never.
If you're reeling from just being fired or re-engineered out of a job, then you've just swallowed one heaping serving of rejection. Be mindful of what Sylvester Stallone said.
I take rejection as someone blowing a bugle in my ear to wake me up and get going, rather than retreat.
We all deal with rejection differently.
But if you're in the sales game, you better get used to it, because rejection is, and always will be, part of business. Too many people just give up. Ascending the career ladder of life is a matter of getting nods of approval from the powers that be. In order to get the yeses, you must hear the noes.
Here is my advice in dealing with rejection, because Lord knows I've had plenty over my career. Don't take it personally. Don't consider yourself a failure if you get rejected. You're a much bigger person than the way your last job packaged you. Take stock of your personal inventory. The sooner you think in terms of your breadth of skills and talents, the quicker you will find constructive ways to move on. Leave the last door open. While you may be retooling your new identity, don't waste time with venom for the past. So what if the job wasn't tailor-made for you? Blaming your last boss and your former company gets you nowhere. Consider that experience to have been invaluable to get you to the next run. Embrace the philosophy I underscore in the title of my book, We Got Fired, and it's the best thing that ever happened to us. Visualize the day when you can visit your last employer and actually thank him or her for the opportunity that was opened up for you. Remember as well that, on a practical level, you will need these people for references and goodwill within your industry. Never say no for the other person. Don't anticipate rejection based on your immediate past experience. Indeed, you may have to polish up your attitude and credentials. On the other hand, you may also find employers who like you very much as you are. Be flexible and test the market. Find out what feels natural for you, but also listen to others, recruiters, interviewers, and trusted friends and advisors. You'll have to present yourself in a way that's both digestible for the marketplace and acceptable to you. Analyze every failure, but never wallow in one. I always want to know why people say no, and I'm not afraid to ask. Was it me? Was it the condition of the economy? How about the particular needs of the firm or the department of that point in time? Be wide open to changing yourself, but be careful about trying to remake yourself to answer circumstances beyond your control. Remember past achievements. Reflect on your past career and business successes. How did you feel? When did you shine your best? And be honest and up to date. Don't spotlight the kinds of career successes that are no longer possible in an industry or market that has changed forever. Take a break. If you're feeling down, do something you like. Exercise. Read a motivational book. Listen to a favorite song. Just don't stay away too long. And never take a break when you're on a hot streak, only when you're in a slump. If a sudden streak of contacts and job prospects springs up, you may have already made the necessary adjustments in how you're presenting yourself. As a young actor and comedian, Jerry Seinfeld had a small recurring role as a mail carrier on the TV sitcom Benson. One day, Jerry showed up for a script read-through, only to find out that he hadn't been issued a script. When he asked why, he was told that he'd been fired. No one had remembered to inform him. Embarrassed, Jerry left the studio determined to stay out of sitcoms until he had more control over the process. A few years later, he succeeded, in more ways than one, when he co-created the hit series Seinfeld, which ran for 9 seasons on NBC and topped the Nielsen ratings for 2 years.
Getting fired, downsized, laid off, let go, or whatever term you want to use, once left a stigma. Now it is standard procedure. More and more people find themselves looking for work, and things are not going to change soon. Rejection is the order of the day. It's acceptance that's the exception. Two men wrote a book containing a collection of inspirational stories. The two authors figured it would take about 3 months to find a publisher. What happened next is as uplifting as any of the stories in their book. The first publisher they approached said no. The second publisher said no. The third publisher said no. The next 30 publishers said no. Altogether, they received 33 rejections over a period of 3 years. So what did they do? They submitted their book to still another publisher. The 34th publisher said yes. After 33 rejections, that one yes launched the spectacular publishing success of Chicken Soup for the Soul, written and compiled by my good friends Jack Canfield and Mark Victor Hansen. The Chicken Soup for the Soul series has so far sold more than 30 million copies, all because Canfield and Hansen had the willingness to fail over and over, and to keep going until they succeeded. Mackay's moral: don't get dejected if you've been rejected. Just get your new you perfected. Chapter 9. Parting Words. Canned Remarks Upon Getting Canned. When people are fired, many look at their last words as a chance to ventilate all the venom and frustration that may be within them. It's their final chance to retaliate before clearing out their desk, the career equivalent of a trip to the firing squad. Be very careful about that attitude. It can be costly and dangerously terminal for your career. The best way to part company with your present employer is almost always on as good a set of terms as reality allows. The situation is strikingly similar to losing a customer when you were in sales. In sales, you have to understand that how you exit an account is just as critical as how you enter into a relationship. Regaining the goodwill of former employers can be as important as pursuing a new one. It may seem refreshing to dive into a new pool of contacts today. But first, don't forget this. From an efficiency standpoint, you already have an established relationship on which to build. It's simply one that has, for some reason, gone awry. That means how you end an association is fundamental to the possibility of beginning a new one. Second, the person to whom you choose to rage may well be answering a recruiter's call in a reference check, or even working for an entirely new employer months from now. When you lose a job, consider the first thing we say to a lost customer at Mackay Mitchell Envelope Company. Thank you for giving us your business all these years. And we say it with sincerity and mean it. The next is, what can we do to make it an easy transition for you? And finally, if things don't work out, we're ready, willing, and able to consider stepping right back in. We sure would love to keep in touch with you from time to time. And we do. Let's say the job you were losing is one you dearly wanted to keep, or an affiliation with an organization you deeply loved. Surely look at all your options. But from the moment you lose that spot, start to visualize the day you will win them back. Imagine the lunch or the golf game you will enjoy together to celebrate your return. Then plan out each painstaking, detailed, and hard-to-swallow step you would need to take to reinstate yourself. Don't make it an obsession, but do make it an option. Mackay's moral: he or she who burns bridges better be a damn good swimmer. Quickie: the stretch marks of experience. Man's mind, once stretched by a new idea, never regains its original dimensions, said Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes, Jr., one of history's most distinguished members of the Supreme Court. Reflect for a moment on Holmes' wisdom. A mind stretched by a new experience can never go back to its old dimensions. Every time you search out a new job, and the trail proves to be a dead end, frustration takes the wind out of your sails. Every interview that goes badly and leads to rejection sparks a feeling of failure. Every last round candidacy where you almost land a job sinks you into depression. Those negative, self-destructive reactions earmark defeatist thinking. Debrief yourself after each reversal, and you will usually find a wealth of learning about how to improve your resume, your pitch, your positioning, your explanation of why you lost your last job, and your plan for making your next job a success. When does a setback become a real loss? If you didn't learn something new and important about yourself and your capabilities. Chapter 10. A Checklist for Checking Out. It's as important to negotiate your termination from your present employer as well as you negotiate your next position with a new organization. Following are just some of the considerations. While you want to receive everything that you are entitled to get, it's always in your best interest to maintain positive relationships and not to burn bridges to future opportunities. Have a clear, written understanding of what your former company will say about your termination. If you are not terminated for cause, poor performance, or violation of company policy, try to secure letters of recommendation from former supervisors. Know if you can ask prospective employers to contact the company as references. If former bosses will say unflattering things about you, do your best to find this out in advance. If there is a possibility your company will rehire you in a better economy, see if the termination can be repositioned as a leave of absence. You may forego some severance pay, but your resume may look better as a result. If you are considering a return to school, the leave of absence may also be a natural explanation. If you are asked to take early retirement, make sure your benefits are carefully calculated. If you don't have another employer lined up, examine what you need to do to extend healthcare coverage. How will perquisites, such as club memberships or company cars, be addressed? If you have unused vacation or sick day credits, how can this time be converted into hard cash? If you are eligible for a partial year bonus or stock options, establish how and when payments will be made. Confirm what items of information you are entitled to retain, such as client and prospect lists. Review any employment agreements to determine if you are bound by any non-compete clauses. Quickie: crying societies or support groups. Losing a job is traumatic, especially if it's your first time through the meat slicer, and if your financial situation is already a tightrope walk. Because the job loss experience sabotages confidence, a support group can be made to order to rebuild self-confidence. Internet support groups have both convenience advantages and privacy risks, which I'll describe in a moment. A support group is positive when it helps restore confidence, and negative when it degenerates into a crying society. Remember that job number one when you lose a job is getting a job. Spending a lot of time with similarly out-of-work people may strengthen your feeling of moral outrage that you were unjustly fired. It may also do nothing about your getting a job, and might in fact amplify the unhealthy feelings that you are an unwanted, flawed human being. Dr. Mark D. Feldman of the University of Alabama has warned about sympathy seekers who invade internet support groups. People can invent or induce fictitious illnesses in themselves or others in order to gain sympathy. What holds true for illness-based alliances can afflict any sort of support group. Often people who are either unaffected or mildly affected will exhaust the group's time and subvert its positive purposes. As with any internet-based communication, be conscious that anyone can be listening in, and that includes former employers and executive recruiters. Chapter 11. Gone to Potter. If you go out of your way to get yourself fired, do it to build a bridge to your next career. According to Inc.com, J.K. Rowling was a former secretary who was once fired for writing short stories at her computer and used her severance pay to help finance the first Harry Potter book.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.